Roman, most recently, Switzerland, a country that is typically neutral, adopted the sanctions on Russia that were imposed by the European Union. The U.S., of course, and some of its allies imposing sanctions over the course of the past few days. Give us an idea of how effective this kind of economic punishment is.
Well, the first round announced about 5 days ago didn't seem terribly effective, and the Russian stock exchange, in fact, bounced back after they were announced. But the latest round, which includes freezing central bank reserves, that was actually an unexpected additional measure that was taken. Well, the Russian stock exchange didn't open at all on Monday. That's the amount of shock it generated, plus the ruble tanked, losing over 50% of its value. So these are the kind of killer sanctions that were discussed, and they are already having a significant impact. And the fact that neutral countries like Switzerland, like Finland, like Austria are also imposing them just shows how the revulsion against Putin's aggressive brutality is growing.
Give us an idea, when you look back in history, how powerful of a national security tool are sanctions?
You know, they've been used, and they've been used against Iran. They've been used against North Korea. They've never been used against a country as both physically and relatively economically big as Russia. Now, there have been some exceptions made, one being that energy payments can still be processed, because I think there's a general desire to not generate a spike in prices, partly because people are thinking about consumers in the US, in the EU, in Canada, but also because it would indirectly generate more profits for Russia and Putin. So I think that's an exception that's actually wise.
You had touched on some of the impacts that we have seen because of these sanctions with respect to the ruble going down and interest rates going up. How much of a deterrent do you think this is from your vantage point with respect to the Russian president, I guess, escalating this war in Ukraine?
It would be a significant deterrent to a person in a normal frame of mind. Sadly, I think President Putin is no longer there in the normal frame of mind. There were attempts at peace talks today. Right after they ended, a ballistic missile landed just outside Kiev. So I don't see any diminution in the level of violence that Putin is directing here. And I think he's living in his own mind. The Russian delegation to the talks said, "We've come without preconditions." At the same time, President Putin said to President Macron of France, "Here are my three conditions." So he's living in his own head, and it's not a nice place to be.
Roman, your thoughts on the lack of involvement by NATO and NATO countries?
Is understandable given the kinds of threats that President Putin has been uttering about implied nuclear responses to direct involvement. You know, I still think that there could be scope for anti-missile involvement, which doesn't involve direct combat between people from the two sides. This is a prudent choice, and it's one that was telegraphed by NATO way in advance. What we are seeing, though, is indirect engagement. The European Union, for the first time in its history, is buying and transferring fighter aircraft to Ukraine. Soviet-made originally, but remodeled to NATO standards, which the Ukrainians were getting either last night or today. agreement of Western governments to allow people to join Ukraine's new international legion. These are all ways, without becoming directly militarily involved, that NATO countries are now leaning way further ahead than they used to.
With respect to Canada's response to the war in Ukraine, we've seen Canada send lethal and non-lethal military aid, monetary aid, impose sanctions. Can Canada do more?
Well, I think Canada did take the lead on financial support for Ukraine. I think 620 million Canadian in loans. And also in organizing this freeze of central bank reserves, where I think Finance Minister Freeland played a key role in putting together that coalition. What more can we do? I think doing more on humanitarian. We are already, from what I understand today, providing more weapons to Ukraine. We'll have to see what new needs emerge. This is a situation where daily new things are happening.
Roman, we're seeing pressures on the military front, the diplomatic, cyber, humanitarian efforts, financial. How do all of these elements play out when it comes to global security and the alliances that you see forming?
President Putin in 2014 largely united Ukraine against him. What he's doing now is he's created sort of geostrategic Europe. The European Union, everyone would complain that it reacts very slowly, it's clunky. They've been acting at lightning speed over the last 4 days. There's been a complete 180 degree change in German foreign and security policy vis-a-vis Russia and Ukraine. So France is now very much engaged in the European pillar of NATO. And President Macron used to talk about NATO as being brain dead. Now France is saying, we're not gonna be frightened or cowed by Putin's talk about nuclear weapons, because we, France, have our force de frappe and we're a nuclear power too. So huge changes in the European Euro-Atlantic security landscape. Very bad news, of course, for Ukraine in terms of daily losses. The country is doing better than anyone expected, including some of the Ukrainians, in terms of fighting back the Russian onslaught, earning a lot of credit abroad, but also a consolidation of its neighbors and the European continent generally on security issues.
Roman, lastly, before we let you go, I understand that the Ukrainian president has signed an application for Ukraine to join the European Union. Give us an idea of how long this process could take and whether or not there's any support that could come with it now.
Well, President Duda of Poland, where I'm talking to you from, yesterday said he favors an express path to membership for Ukraine. I think that a few other Central and Eastern European leaders have said the same. European Union membership is usually a 10, 15 year process. But in the case of Ukraine, just simply everyone agreeing that it has a fair chance. In other words, opening the negotiations on this, which previously weren't even on the table, would already be a huge advance. So I'm not expecting Ukraine to be in the European Union next week, but I am expecting a change in signals and maybe even some consensus on the prospect of opening negotiations.